Dear all, on behalf of RPG Life Sciences Urology Division, I would like to welcome you for today's webinar, which is on renal calculi, its diagnosis and management. Today we have with us Dr. Subodh Das. He is going to speak us on clinical management of renal calculi and he is going to share his experiences. Dr. Subodh Das, he has done MCH Urology. Presently he is Director Transplant and Renal Sciences, AMRI Hospitals, Bhubaneswar, India. Today, sir is going to help us to understand the diagnosis, etiology, pathology, and the management part of the renal calculi. Without taking much time, I would like to welcome today's speaker, Dr. Subodh Das. Sir, over to you. Thank you.
Thank you once again. Okay, now we'll move ahead. The discussion will be basically on urinary stone disease, and the focus will be on medical expulsion therapy. So, this is basically the anatomy of the urinary tract. The kidney, the ureter, the bladder, urethra, they all together constitute the urinary tract in the males and females. Yeah, regarding the prevalence of stone disease, in worldwide the prevalence is 5 to 15%. Recurrence rate of stone disease is up to 50%. Incidence is more in men than women. And peak age in men for this stone disease is 30 years. Women we get 35 and 55 years. The risk factors are obesity and metabolic syndrome. Depending on the location, we can categorize the stones into like renal stones or kidney stones, ureteric stones that are called ureterolithiasis. And when they are in the bladder, they are cystolithiasis. And sometimes some stones can get stuck in the urethra. Then in that case, we call them as urethral stones. Usually, they drop down from the bladder. Now, the various renal stones, depending on the composition. Yeah, the most common is calcium oxalate. They account for almost 80% of all renal stones. And this occurs usually when the urinary pH decreases, that is acidic pH. The color is usually black or dark brown. And they are radiopaque stones. Most of the stones are radiopaque, except for xanthine stones, which I have mentioned at the last. Next common stones are calcium phosphate. This is the stone that occurs in alkalized urine. They are dirty white in color. Uric acid stones, they account for 5 to 10% of all stones. This occurs when the urine is persistently acidic. They are yellow or reddish brown in color. 10 to 15% of stones are struvite in nature, the triple phosphate, ammonium magnesium phosphate stones. Infection, recurrent urinary infection is a common predisposing factor where the urinary pH is alkaline. They are dirty white in color. Cystine stones, they are radiorupic. They are known to occur in rare genetic disorders called cystinuria. They may account for almost 1 to 2% of stones, and they're pink or yellow in color. Xanthine stones occur in interior. They're extremely rare stones. They're brick red and they are radiolucent. Ureteral stones, they contribute to 20% of all stones in the urinary tract. And 70% of them, mind you, 70% of ureteric stones are located in the distal ureter. What are the various causes of kidney stones? Yeah, the most common is usually low fluid intake, the dehydration, which alters the urinary concentration. The more concentrated the urine is, more likely the patient to have stones. Altered urinary pH, like uric acid, cystine acid, they are the stones that occur in acidic pH. Recurrent urinary infections give rise to struvite stones, that is triple phosphate stones, and that is due to urease product produced by the various bacteria which cause urinary infection. Apart from them, there are several anatomic causes like pelvic junction obstruction, horseshoe kidney, bladder diverticulum, medullary sponge kidney. They can cause urinary stone disease. Like in pelvic junction obstruction, horseshoe kidney, it is usually due to obstructive pathology. In diverticulum, it is usually because the urine becomes stagnant. And medullary sponge kidney, they are metabolic in nature. Various dietary causes like high animal protein, excess intake of oxalates in the form of nuts, chocolates, brewed tea, spinach, potatoes, beets, and rhubarb, they can give rise to, again, urinary stone disease. Prolonged immobilization, metabolic causes like cystinuria, hypercalciuria, hyperoxaluria, hyperuricosuria, hyperparathyroidism, they can all give rise to renal stone disease. renal tubular acidosis, that is another metabolic disease that can give rise to urinary stone disease, urolithiasis. Various medications in excess can cause urinary stone disease, like vitamin C, vitamin D, acetazolamide, steroids, triamcinolone, endoprednisone, and tricyclate antacids and laxatives. Tricyclate antacids and laxatives. This is pathophysiology. The first step is, of course, saturation. Then the crystals get supersaturated. Then they get nucleated. Then there occurs crystal growth and aggregation. Then the crystals are retained. And finally, they give rise to stone formation. Yeah, this is just explained. Supersaturation of urine. Sheet crystal may form through the process of nucleation. Nucleation can be heterogeneous or homogeneous. That will ultimately decide on the nature of the stone. There are various inhibitors of stone formation, like two urinary glycoproteins, nefrocalcin and tamm-Horsfall glycoprotein, magnesium and citrate, hypocitrate, that reduces urinary supersaturation of calcium salts by forming soluble complexes. Yeah, now what are the symptoms? We'll come to the clinical feature. Most common is usually pain. It's acute urinary colic or acute chronic flank, abdominal or groin pain. Sometimes patient comes with hematuria. They may complain of burning or dysuria. They may complain of difficulty in passing urine, anuria, or sometimes urine production is absolutely stopped. Patient may present with urinary tract infection, nausea, and vomiting. Remember, this is the most common symptom, this urinary colic. Usually, loin to groin pain is the typical of lower urinary stones. Stone in the ureter alters the peristalsis of ureter. Normally, the peristalsis is rhythmic. There is rhythmic contraction and relaxation. And if the contraction remains rhythmic, then this gives rise to finally an expulsion of the stone. But what happens when the stone gets impacted, the rhythmic contractions are lost, ureter gets into spasm, and there are arrhythmic contractions and relaxations that again facilitates the lodging of the stone and impaction of the stone. I have just explained it, the lost stone gives rise to spasm, gives rise to arrhythmic contractions of the ureteric musculature, and the lost stone causes local irritation, edema, and inflammation, and this gives rise to pain, hematuria, and difficult to pass urine. And finally, once the stone gets lost and impacted, it becomes difficult for the stone for automatic passage. Now, what are the complications? A chronically impacted stone can give rise to obstruction and proximal hydroureteronephrosis. As you can see here, the proximal hydroureteronephrosis because of the stone here. The stagnant urine is exposed to infection. The stone is impacted. A long-standing impacted ureteric stone can cause stricture of the ureter. How do we investigate a patient with suspected urinary stone disease? The patient who comes with the symptoms, they should be subjected to a routine screening ultrasound in the emergency. X-ray KUB will reveal the radio-opaque stones, which are more than 4 millimeter. And the investigation of choice is a plain CT KUB that usually invariably reveals the stone and its location. Contrast CT KUB will give us some idea about the functional assessment of the kidneys. And it can be planned in case of large renal stones and if we are planning surgical management later. Yeah. The baseline investigations are urine routine and microscopy, urine culture, a complete blood count, renal function test for urea and creatinine, because many times patients come with a compromised renal function, serum calcium, serum uric acid. And if the surgery is planned, then of course the patient should be subjected to PT and INR. Now, what are the preventive measures? As I told in the initial slides, that dehydration is a predisposing factor for renal stones. So, increase in fluid intake should be advised. The patient should be advised to at least have 2.5 to 3 liters of fluid per day, or maintaining the diuresis of 2 to 2.5 liters per day. Now, nutritional advice, like patient should have a balanced diet, which should be rich in vegetable and fiber, and the intake of normal calcium, low sodium, and low animal protein. Lifestyle advice includes adequate physical activity, reduction of weight, and maintenance of normal BMI. Yeah, what are the drugs used, the medical treatment? Drugs used is like I told you, an acidic environment promotes the formation of stones. So urinary alkalizers are one of the most common agents used. And this includes a potassium citrate, which can be given in the form of syrup or tablet at a dose of 5 to 12 gram per day. Diuretics in the form of thiazides, allopurinol at a dose of 300 milligram per day, and febuxostat 80 to 120 milligram per day. And analgesics for pain and antispasmodics like drotavirine and tramadol can also be given for symptomatic relief. So we'll just explain why alkalizers. They neutralize the acidic nature of the urine. They reduce and increase of protective urinary analytes like citrate, potassium, and pH, and a decrease of calcium oxalate supersaturation. This reduces the formation of crystals in urine that could become kidney stones. They reduces the rate of stone recurrence and increases the clearance rates and dissolution of stone fragments. Ancient method was open stone surgery. It has almost become obsolete nowadays. We are hardly practicing open surgery, open methods for removal of stones in urinary tract. Extracorporeal shockwave lithotripsy, I will come to it later. Ureteroscopy through a semi-rigid or flexible ureteroscope. Percutaneous nephrolithotomy, which can be a conventional PCNL or micro or mini PCNL. Laparoscopic approach for removal of stones. And of late, the robotics has got into the treatment of renal stone disease. This is a picture of a typical ESWL machine, extracorporeal shockwave lithotripsy. This you can see, patient sleeps here. Shockwaves, many forms of shockwaves are there. I will not get into the technical details. They directly hit the stone. They hit the stone, the stones break into pieces, and a few sittings, the stones pass in the urine. And this is ureteroscopy, where, and this is shockwaves. This is the just internal picture, how the shockwaves hit the stone, and the stone gets broken into fragments. Where is the scope of conservative management? What is the place? 90% of stones are less than 5 mm and 15% of stones between 5 and 8 millimeter pass within 4 weeks. 95% of those larger than 8 mm require urological intervention. So basically stones which are more than 8 mm size will require intervention, some kind of intervention, and they will not respond to medical treatment most commonly. And what do we mean by conservative management? This includes avoidance of diets that predispose to stone formation, drink plenty of water, analgesics and antispasmodics for pain. What is MET? This is medical expulsive therapy used for treatment of renal stones. It is administration of medicines to relax the ureter and allow spontaneous passage of ureteric stones. What are the agents we give for medical expulsion therapy? Basic target is to relax the ureteric musculature, to regularize the ureteric spasm so that the ureter has a rhythmic contraction rather than having arrhythmic spasms, and the rhythmic contraction and relaxation ultimately lead to release of the stone. So what do we use? We use alpha blockers for the same purpose, and along with them we use a short course of steroids and analgesics. These are the receptors at different places of the ureter. This is upper ureter, mid ureter, and lower ureter. In the upper ureter, alpha-1D is the most predominant and alpha-1A is the rarest. In mid ureter, again alpha-1D, same, alpha-1A, then alpha-1B. And in the lower ureter, again, it is alpha-1D more than alpha-1A, and the rarest variety is alpha-1D. So the basic target is to block the alpha-1D receptors and alpha-1A receptors. This blockade of these receptors leads to dilatation of the ureter, and this increases the rate of expulsion of the stone. As I have just explained, these are the receptors present in the distal ureter. The blocking relieves the spasm around large stone by relaxing the smooth muscles. The arrhythmic peristalsis is corrected. This increases the pressure gradient around the stone, which finally propels the ureteric stones. Agents used for relaxation of the ureter. What were the alpha blockers we used? Tamsulosin. This is a uroselective alpha-1A and alpha-1D receptor blocker. This relaxes the smooth muscle, relieves the spasm, corrects the arrhythmic peristalsis, maintains a normal peristalsis, and finally this normal peristalsis and the dilatation of the ureter can give rise to release of the stone. Side effects are postural hypotension and retrograde ejaculation. This agent is very commonly used in the treatment of benign prostatic hyperplasia, and this is an additional use where it can be used for removal of the stones. Yeah, what are the role of steroids? Impaction of the stone causes inflammation around the stone and edema. A long-standing lodged stone can give rise to more inflammation, more edema, and chances of long-term stricture. So the purpose of giving steroids is to reduce the inflammation. This is how they work. The corticosteroids, they inhibit the conversion of phospholipids to arachidonic acid. And finally, they block this pathway that lead to the release of prostaglandins. Diflucicort is the steroid most commonly used for medical expulsion therapy. This inhibits the conversion of lipoxygenase prostaglandin synthesis, inhibits recruitment of inflammatory cells. This reduces edema, facilitates the stone expulsion. This inhibits stricture formation by minimizing the ureteric mucosal inflammation. What are the other drugs used? Nifedipine and PDE5 inhibitor like tadalafil. They are the few other drugs which have been tried, and some of them are still in use in the medical expulsion therapy for stone disease. What are the indications of medical expulsion therapy? And the patient should be well informed. He should be having symptoms which are tolerable to him, and it should be without any association with urinary tract infections, and stones in the ureter should be less than 10 millimeter. Yeah, now what are the contraindications? A patient having a solitary functioning kidney, having active urinary tract infection, patient having intractable pain, and having impaired renal function. They are the features which do not merit the use of medical expulsion therapy in ureteric stones. When do you decide to discontinue medical expulsion therapy? Suppose the patient is developing infection, when he complains of fever with chills and rigors, when he complains of burning in urination, then you suspect infection, and in such a situation you need to stop the medical expulsion therapy. Patient having refractory pain and patient who has a deteriorating renal function, you need to stop the medical expulsion therapy. So a lodged stone gives rise to spasm, gives rise to arrhythmic peristalsis, gives rise to edema and inflammation, and gives rise to pain, hematuria, and difficulty in passaging the stone. Now the efficacy of various agents I just discussed in treating the stones in the form of medical expulsion therapy. As you can see, analgesics alone can give rise to a 33.3% expulsion. Deflagacort alone has a success rate of 37.5%. Alpha blocker in the form of temsulosin has a success rate of 60%. And the combination of alpha blocker and steroid like temsulosin plus deflagacort, they can have a success rate as high as 84.5%. This is the expulsion rate. So this is the most preferred combination, right? Yeah, what is the average expulsion time? If you use temsulosin alone, it is average is 5 days. The combination of temsulosin plus deflagacort is used, the expulsion time is 3 days. Yeah, what are the benefits of medical expulsion therapy? The benefits are, obviously, the first benefit is that you are avoiding surgery. Patient is not subjected to a surgical intervention for the stone disease. And he has a shortened time to pause the stone, fewer pain episodes, less amount of analgesics required, hospitalization, endoscopic treatment is required less frequently, and there is a chance of spontaneous stitches of stones of size up to 10 mm. Yeah, as I have just explained, higher expulsion rate for a combination of alpha blocker and steroids. And once they are combined, ureter is very fast relaxed, inflammation is reduced, edema is reduced. Since ureter is relaxed and reduced, edema is there, infection is reduced, so patients' analgesic requirements are also reduced, and together they improve the overall success rate of stone expulsion. And this reduces the chances of readmission to the hospital. So treatment of ureteric stones by medical expulsion therapy has a huge under scope in urology. Thank you. Thank you for giving me this opportunity to share my knowledge on urinary stones.
Yeah, thank you, sir. We'll have some questions from the audience.
Absolutely.
Yeah, you can type your questions in chat box or Q&A section. We'll give you 30 seconds more. So you can just type and then we'll ask our expert to comment on those questions. Yeah, one question is this, sir. Based on the clinically for a general physician, what could be the cutoff size of stone where it needs to be referred to urologist? In ureteric stones, I am talking about more specifically ureteric stones.
Yeah, if a general physician is seeing a patient, then ideally any ureteric stone, small renal stones of 4-5 mm, they need not refer. They can start this medical treatment. But for ureteric stones, irrespective of size, ideally it should be referred to a urologist. But in case the urologist is not available, for stones up to, as I have told, up to 8 mm, they can start medical expulsion therapy. But provided patient has undergone all these investigations, including the plain CT KOB, and he should merit into the treatment under medical expulsion therapy, and there should not be any contraindication for MET.
Right. Sir, as your surgeon, so what are the most preferred surgical options? Specifically nephrolithiasis, urolithiasis, cystolithiasis. So what exactly most preferred? Yeah, many a times patient comes to us and they ask us about the type of surgeries.
Surgical options for renal stones are usually either you go for a lithotripsy, they have their own indications, or PCNL, mini PCNL, micro PCNL, and laparoscopy.
Okay.
PCNL is the most common modality of treatment done as far as surgical options are concerned for renal stone disease.
Okay.
Now, regarding the ureteric stones, it all depends on the location. For upper ureteric stones, usually either you go for a lithotripsy or you go for a PCNL or IRS, that is retrograde intrarenal surgery, where you go from below with a flexible ureteroscope, break the stone with laser. And for mid ureter and lower ureteric stones, you can go for a rigid ureteroscopy and breaking the stone with various energy sources. So basically RIRS for upper ureteric stones, middle and lower ureteric rigid ureteroscopy, and renal stones, PCNL. They are the most common modalities used as far as surgical options are concerned.
Sir, there are a few questions appearing right now.
Okay.
Dr. Vimal Mishra is asking, use of Barberi vulgaris.
Sorry?
Use of Barberi vulgaris, and do we send expelled calculus for histopathology?
Yeah. Regarding use of this agent, I have no idea. I am just concerned about what medical expulsion therapy we used in our allopathic science, number one. Number two, do we send it for histopathology? Yeah, we don't send it for histopathology. We send it usually for stone analysis, so that you can know the exact nature of the stone. And depending on that, you can advise about, like, say, suppose patient has a cystine stone, patient has a uric acid stone, and you can evaluate accordingly to see if the patient has any other underlying disease, right? So you don't send it for histopathology, you send it for analysis of the stone, so just to see what is the chemical composition of the stone.
Dr. Chandresh Gangwar is asking, sir, what are the contraindications of ESWL and which is the hardest stone cystine or calcium monooxalate?
Yeah. Regarding contraindications for ESWL, patient having bleeding diathesis, like those patients having any bleeding disorder, patients who were on anticoagulants or antiplatelets and pregnancy. These are absolute contraindications for ESWL.
Sir, what's the role of, what as a general practitioner, what could be the basic diagnostic test? Either X-rays or USG, what would be? What would you like to comment on this?
Yeah, I just forgot to answer the other part of the previous question actually. Cysteine and calcium monooxalate. Calcium monooxalate is the hardest stone. Cysteine is also hard, and both of them are considered to be hard stones. So they do not respond very well sometimes to lithotripsy. Okay. What's your question? Sorry.
As a general practitioner, when patient comes with the pain and
investigations. The basic investigation is basically we should go for a screening ultrasound first. That gives you a brief idea of location of the stone, size of the stone. Then depending on that, we can move ahead with other investigations.
Right.
So Dr. Vimal Mishra is asking, which fruits are to be avoided?
For?
Which fruits?
Fruit is to be avoided? Sorry?
Which fruits are to be avoided?
Yeah. There is no particular fruit actually which increases the stone disease. So we don't recommend any complete avoidance of any kind of fruit in stone disease. Some of the, that I told, the spinach and all those dietary restrictions, you can reduce the amount of intake of such diets. But complete avoidance is not recommended for any kind of fruit.
So there's
Uric acid stone, sir, for uric acid stones, do you recommend allopurinol and febuxostat, those patients who are suffering from hyper?
Patient is having recurrent uric acid stones, you have to see the serum uric acid, and if it is beyond the reference range, then we do start them on febuxostat or allopurinol.
Okay.
So, sir, there's another question. Hello, sir. My question is, how to deal with a patient with single kidney who suffers with kidney stone or any other kidney disease?
Yeah.
Shall we give them the same amount of dosage or treatment, or there will be any changes in treatment?
Yeah. First stage, if a patient is having a solitary functioning kidney with a ureteric stone, then medical expulsion therapy is ruled out. You should not try this because this is a precious kidney and you need to save it. So you should not, and depending on the dosage of medication, well, if the patient is normal urea and creatinine, the dosage remains same. And if it is altered renal function, then it has to be tapered accordingly. But medical expulsion therapy is not recommended for patients having a solitary functioning kidney. You should ideally go for a surgical intervention, because sometimes if the medical expulsion therapy fails, then in the trial, the patient may have an increased urea and creatinine and may land up in a compromised renal function. So it should ideally be avoided.
Yeah, sir. What is your practical opinion on the usage of diclofenac versus tramadol? Because diclofenac has nephrotoxicity potential.
We avoid using diclofenac most of the time. Tramadol is nowadays better preferred because the nephrotoxicity of diclofenac. Okay. But in case of severe pain, you can give it for a shorter duration at a low dose.
Okay. Yeah.
So, sir, any drug which should be avoided during MET?
Yeah. You should avoid using like diclofenac, I just told. MET has its own group of medications that you give. And those which are likely to interact with these medications should be avoided. Like tamsulosin, as I told, sometimes can give rise to postural hypotension. So if the patient is already on some antihypertensives, then you need to monitor his blood pressure, and you might need to stop the other antihypertensive he is taking as long as you are giving him tamsulosin. Otherwise, no specific drug interaction that gives rise to need to avoid any other medicine.
Okay. Sir, which calcium preparation can be safely given to a patient of renal?
See, the calcium intake is not contraindicated in renal stone disease. This is actually a myth that you reduce the calcium intake and the stone disease is reduced. So there is no recommendation that this calcium intake should not be given and this calcium preparation should be given. Calcium intake is not contraindicated.
Sir, what are the alarming signs and symptoms where a general physician needs to be very careful and he has to refer the patient to the urologist?
See, the patient, suppose they have put a patient on medical expulsion therapy and the patient still has intractable pain. Patient is having continuous nausea, vomiting, severe pain, or he has the signs of urinary tract infection, like he develops fever with chills and rigors, he develops severe dysuria, then the patient needs to be referred to a urologist. Another condition is if the patient is having deteriorating renal function, if his urea creatinine starts rising, his urine output decreases, in all these situations, they need to refer the patient to a urologist. And if a patient has a solitary kidney with ureteric stone, they should never try medical expulsion therapy. It should be referred, because it has to be treated most of the time by surgical intervention.
Right. Right. Yeah. So, thank you so much, Subodh sir.
Thank you.
You have been addressing our questions, and many questions are getting resolved. And hope we'll get in touch with you on your email ID and your phone number is there. So, if needed, the physician fraternity will get back to you definitely.
Definitely. I'll be obliged. Right?
Yeah. Thank you once again. Thank you.
Yeah. Right. Bye-bye. Okay.